Welcome to Arcade Attack. A retro gaming podcast for up to four players.
Hey, welcome to another Arcade Attack. I'm your host for today, Rob, and sitting around me are Dylan.
Bonjour.
And Adrian.
I'm here, baby.
And Keith.
Tumbleweed.
Nope, still no Keith.
Sick note still off, eh? All right.
But I have a question for you two. And the question is, hey, it's time to make some crazy money.
Oh yeah.
Are you ready?
We're going to ring it in, ringing the taxi.
That's right. We are, of course, talking about Crazy Taxi today, a game I'm guessing everyone around the circle is familiar with.
Yeah. Become an Uber driver.
Yeah, a little bit, but much more fun than being an Uber driver. Which version are you most familiar with?
Dreamcast and arcade.
Yeah, for me, Dreamcast. Yeah.
Yeah, I think this is a game I played in the arcade, but I think I'm most familiar with the Dreamcast version for reasons I'll get into later on.
Yep, yeah.
But let's go back to the origin of Crazy Taxi, which of course started out in the arcades. It was brought out in 1999. Producer was a guy called Kenji Kano, who actually produced pretty much all the Crazy Taxi games. He joined AM3, Sega's high-tech arcade development arm, pretty much at the time of its inception in 1993. Were you going to say something, Adrian?
No.
Okay. According to the internet, he was best known before this for directing the Jurassic Park arcade game.
Wowza. Yeah.
I don't know if... Do you either of you remember that?
I do. Good game, that.
Shooting game.
Boom. Yeah. Shooting game where you're basically going around in one of those little Jurassic Park jeeps. There are dinosaurs coming at you in
hordes.
There's
one of those being restored at the Heart of Gaming as we speak.
Interesting.
So here we go. Heart of Gaming in Croydon Town, in London Town.
Yes.
Get ready for that.
Yeah, herds of dinosaurs running towards
amazing.
You. And you have
I remember
to do
playing that back in the day. That was
your
amazing.
Best to make them extinct again.
No, was that ever... They came back, and you've got to make them extinct.
Did they ever
again.
Go on any consoles that game? Because
I don't think so. I think a lot of the
game. I think there was a rail shooter, wasn't there, on something? Yeah, but nothing like that.
The thing with those rail shooters were, unless you kind of had a system with an actual kind of a tenant gun on. It was really hard to kind of adapt those. I think, it's like the Alien. Was it Aliens arcade game? Was it Alien 3? The rail shooter arcade game.
It was one of the Alien ones, wasn't it? That's so annoying.
There was a Konami game from the early 90s.
Oh.
Never got adapted from a console, as far as I know.
No.
I mean,
one game was, and that was.
Terminator 2?
Oh, no, Crazy Taxi.
Crazy Taxi.
That's
and
not
Terminator
a rail
2.
No, it's not a rail. Can you imagine if it was, though? Wow.
Terminator 2, the arcade machine.
Well, you'd be looking at more like something like Lucky and Wild.
You love a bit of Lucky and Wild.
I do love a bit of Lucky and Wild. Shooting and, driving.
Shooting and driving. Hello.
But anyway, that was his first game, and the other game he directed came out in 1997, a game I don't know if either of you have played, called Top Skater.
Never heard of it.
Top Skater.
It's an arcade game. It's a little bit like, I guess, Crazy Taxi meets Tony Hawk. So
You're giving people lifts on your skateboard.
Meets Pilot Wings. It's you're going along this, there are some similarities to Crazy Taxi, which we'll be getting to a little bit later. But you're basically going along this, long kind of skate, concrete kind of bowl ramp,
half-pipe,
I guess.
I think.
Yeah, I guess maybe, you're kind of along the track.
You're in the full pipe.
And you basically have to go, I'll tell you what it's like. It's like this, the bonus level in Sonic 2.
Oh.
So, you're kind of doing tricks on, each side of, the ramp as you go along.
Yeah.
And, yeah. It was, pretty. That's obviously cool because, not a big game. But
yeah, a lot of games stole it afterwards. I think all the SSX games stole that. So those, when you learn the snowboard and you go into that.
Mm-hmm.
Don't think it's called a full pipe. I think it is called a half pipe.
And then, yeah, 2 years later, goes on to produce Crazy Taxi. Crazy Taxi was made on Naomi, the late 90s Sega arcade board that followed System 3, which obviously was huge. System 3 was like the Saturn era board where you had Daytona USA 2, Sega Rally 2, Virtua Fighter 3, and Sega Bass Fishing.
You can tell it was a significant step up from those games.
Yeah, Naomi was on, was basically House Visit, Dead 2, Virtua Tennis, and I think by this point, Sega were also kind of renting it out to other developers. Mm. So I think like the biggest game that was made by a non-Sega developer on the Naomi board was Marvel vs. Capcom 2.
I love that game.
Don't know if you remember that
one. I love that game, silly.
Yeah. That particular one was like the, wanna take you for a ride era. Yeah.
Love it.
Anyway, the premise for anyone who hasn't played Crazy Taxi, I'm guessing most of our listeners would have.
They must have lived, if you've not played it, you must have lived in like a cave or something, I don't know, like for the last 20 years.
It is a really iconic game. It's had a lot of sequels, but the sequels are very close to the original.
Yeah.
And the premise
understatement.
Is, of course, that you're a cab driver in like an open top yellow cab, which they all the cabs look great. Like, there's four different characters, four slightly different cabs, but oh, they all look so cool. Mm-hmm. And you have to drive around a city picking up as many passengers as possible and transporting them to various destinations within that city as fast as you possibly can. Mm-hmm. And as with all general arcade games, you have a time limit and you get more time every time you drop off a passenger. So the faster you kind of travel, it is possible to kind of make up that time if you're very good at the game and kind of build up reserves, especially like... You kind of look at people and they have these little kind of circles around them, like red circle for a short trip, yellow for medium, and I think orange in the first game for like a long one. I could be red, maybe, I'm not sure, but
I just picked up whoever, I didn't even know that related. I didn't know that related to the distance.
I remembered, red is short distance, orange is medium, and green is long.
Green, yeah, I thought green was in
Do you know what, I got an Uber cab recently with Kev actually to James's house.
You did.
And I got it from Kev's house and I put it in all Uber and we went to the middle of nowhere and the Uber driver had a go at me going, oh, I'm never going to get a person the way back here. You've made me drive out all the way out here for nothing. And you know, he was quite angry at me, but then luckily we support the same football team. So we started talking about that and he wasn't so angry at me.
But doesn't Uber give them a destination before they pick
you
up?
Yeah. So he's like, I don't know why I accepted this. He was quite grumpy about it.
He shouldn't have accepted it.
Hey, I had an orange circle around me.
You had an orange circle. He knew what he was in.
He could have rejected me. Yeah. He didn't.
Anyway, like, this is kind of a closed world, and there aren't an infinite number of people. Like, there are a set number of people within the city who need to be picked up, and once you drop someone off, they drop off the map. Mm-hmm. So you can't go on doing it indefinitely.
Oh, no, you can't. Yeah, keep going to the same guy, no.
Yeah, but you can go for, like, a long time. And, like, this game takes place in a fictional version of L.A., a very small fictional version of, I guess, maybe not L.A., but, like, a generic Californian city. And filled with famous brands, such as...
Sega?
No. Places where people might want to go. Take me to KFC. That's one of them.
KFC's in there.
KFC's in one. Pizza Hut. Fila. As in, like, the Athletics store, I guess. The Athletics brand have their own store.
Oh, God, yeah, there were so many sponsors in it now.
I've never seen a Fila store in real life, but apparently...
There must be one over in LA or something.
And Tower Records, another extinct brand.
Oh, my God.
And Blockbuster. No, I'm joking. Toys R Us.
Oh, it would have been amazing if they had a Blockbuster in there.
I think they got one last Blockbuster survive, haven't they, right now? There's one left.
That's the one in Captain Marvel.
Well, maybe, but in real life, I mean.
And, like, there are basically, what's the most fun about this is being an arcade game. One thing I love about Crazy Taxi, the game, is that it's not like a serious game. You don't have to worry about taking damage or, like, kind of being responsible. You can basically go as fast as you want, crash into anything you want, crash into any car you want. And it's not like GTA either. You can't run people over. They always jump out the way before you get to them.
I will admit to having tried to run people over in it.
Oh, Dylan.
I know, sorry.
Scandalous.
Sorry.
GTA has infected your mind, just like the churches and the parents said it would.
I just think Crazy Taxi was great because it was like, well, not an open world game, but it gave you the option to do anything, really. We were moving that in that direction, weren't we, of like Grand Theft Auto and stuff, weren't we?
Yeah, like you can go up and down hills, I can up and down kind of squares. You can go into the sea and pick people up.
Huh?
Yeah.
There are people like, yeah, you go like, you can go onto the beach and pick people up, and then you can keep on driving through the beach into the sea, and there are people like on the seabed wanting to be collected. Yep.
And there's SpongeBob, isn't it?
SpongeBob and, Patrick are in there.
Do you know there's like a theory on what SpongeBob is actually about?
No.
Where does SpongeBob SquarePants live?
Bikini Bottom.
Bikini Bottom sounds a bit like Bikini Atoll. Bikini Atoll being the place in the Pacific Ocean where France did nuclear tests in the 90s.
No.
So the theory is that maybe they were like people like SpongeBob, Squidward, etc. were like kind of ordinary sea creatures that were irradiated. Wow. And became like sentient actual creatures.
We'll never know now.
No.
We'll never know if that's actually what Steven Hillenburg wanted. I don't know.
Maybe they could do a Crazy Taxi SpongeBob kind of spin-off game.
Rest in peace, by the way. Rest in peace.
Yeah, rest in peace.
Great, love SpongeBob. That's a sad story.
Mm. Anyway.
Moving on. Crazy Taxi.
Yeah, you can be four different drivers in four slightly different cars, but they all look kind of the same. They all look like an open-top yellow and black cabs. Anyone remember the names of said drivers?
No, I always went for the first one on the list.
Think Streets of Rage.
Axel, correct.
Axel
steering wheel? Are they all car-related?
No.
No?
There's a guy called BD Joe.
That's definitely not car-related.
What does BD stand for?
It can stand for whatever you want. I can't remember what he looked like, but there's a woman called Gina. I think maybe had red hair. And a guy called Gus, who's like, I think Gus is my favorite. Like an older dude. Looked like, I don't know if he had one, but he looked like the kind of guy who'd be wearing like a beret or like kind of that kind of cap. And he talked like this. Like, yeah, like they were kind of sound, all the characters talked. Not just the cab drivers, they were like, go get in, or
get in.
Yeah, and like the passengers would talk like, going, whoa, if you're kind of going too fast, or they were always talking, always shouting at you. And obviously kind of you get bonus points. Like, it's basically a cash thing. Instead of points, you get cash, and you get cash the faster you drop them off, and you get bonus cash for performing stunts.
Oh.
So, like, if you kind of take a big spill over the hill, I think it's kind of like San Francisco because there are tram tracks going down the hill. You only see a track, but like, there's kind of a loop-de-loop on the hill. So you go to like one hill, and then you go up a bit, and you can like take a massive jump.
Mm-hmm.
And the faster you go off that, the more kind of bonus cash you get. Yeah. And if you're going really fast and you're just missing cars going either direction, you get bonus points for that as well because it's a crazy stunt.
It's a crazy stunt in a crazy taxi game.
Now, question. What is the most memorable part of the game, the most memorable element of the game?
Oh, for me, it was the stress levels because I always the time pressure.
The timer.
I didn't like the timer. And I've said it before, I don't like to feel under pressure in games. It gets me really flustered, and some people, they love the adrenaline.
You can't, because sometimes if there's not much on there, you're like, where's my next fare? And you just go mad.
That's for me, that's why I remember it. I like the game a lot, it's fun and frantic, but for me, I just can't cope very well
with
that craziness.
If you play it on arcade mode, it's already like pretty difficult. Like you have to, like to bump up that clock a bit, you have to get a lot of quick wins straight away. Otherwise it's just, game over again, and they got $2,000.
Well, I think actually you're not. The best way to do it isn't really to go for the quick wins; to go for the long journeys because you can make up more time that way.
Is it? Have I been playing it wrong all these years?
Yeah, possibly. Maybe that's why it's so stressful.
Oh, it's so stressful, but it's so glorious at the same time.
Yeah, I just like the graphics. Actually, I don't know if you're going to talk about that, Rob, but it's just the brightness, the colour. It's got that lovely Sega feel. I know that Keith would agree, wouldn't he? It's got that sort of Sega.
I think, yeah. I mean, I know there's a PS2 version, but I think it looks amazing on the Dreamcast. I think, isn't it like arcade perfect on the Dreamcast?
It is more or less arcade perfect, because this, like, Naomi board was kind of like based along similar lines to the Dreamcast kind of mechanism, I guess. And yeah, it does look amazing. Like, just these perfect blue skies and green grass and like, there's a big like a parking lot like near the kind of, I guess, baseball stadium or wherever. There's a beach. Just everything looks...
There's a good solid feel to everything. Mm. Okay, when you go in the water, it's a bit iffy, but we're talking about a console in the late 90s. Yeah. But we'll probably let that one go. Yeah. But everything else, like on the ground and everything, it's all solid, isn't it? It's like...
And I don't think there's a shred of slowdown either.
No, there's not. I didn't know there's any slowdown in it. I used to play it back in the day on the old Dreamcast.
Do you know what, for me, is the most distinctive element of the game?
No.
It's...
Silent War!
The soundtrack.
Silent War!
Was that Offspring?
It was Offspring.
Oh my god.
You know, like,
Offspring used to be so cool.
For years, I thought that song actually was called Silent War, but it's called All I Want.
Wow. Yeah, All I Want, yeah.
Yeah.
What album is that on?
It's on Ixnay for the Ombre. I think that's what it's called. Ixnay to the Ombre, I think. Okay. Basically, Smash came out in 1994. It was a massive album.
Yep.
And this was a follow-up. This was the one that was after Smash, but before Americana, which had, like, pretty fly for white guys.
And then it all just kind of went
It's when
down.
They went full novelty.
Yeah.
But anyway, this soundtrack has 4 songs by Bad Religion. I don't know if you know them.
Nope.
And 3 songs by Offspring. Now, interesting kind of thing. We talked about Top Skater earlier on. Mm. One of the big elements for Top Skater was all the music was done by another 90s punk band called Pennywise. Don't know if either
I've
of you...
I've heard of Pennywise.
I've heard they're all clowns.
Here we go. But, basically, I don't know if you've heard of the record label Epitaph. One of the best...
No,
yeah, you're both
probably.
Shaking your heads. Basically, one of the best, probably the best punk label of the 90s. Maybe the best indie label of the 90s, which that's a big claim, I know. Ooh. But, basically, like, Pennywise, Offspring, especially Bad Religion, are the 3 bands that most kind of define the Epitaph sound. And, yeah, Pennywise, like, basically 2 of their best 90s albums were the basis for Top Skater.
Yeah, how did Sega have their finger so on the pulse with this?
Apparently, the developers were, like, felt like you needed that kind of music in the background, and they were actually fans of that music to begin with. So I believe
it's hard to disagree.
I'm pretty sure they actually kind of, I guess, approached Epitaph for licensing stuff. Maybe Kenji Kano was a big punk fan, but this game Crazy Taxi has 4 Bad Religion songs, none of which are really that memorable. 3 Offspring songs. I think the 2 everyone remembers are All I Want and I'm Just Ready to Get Way Down the Line.
I don't know that one as much. But...
Okay, well.
And is this in the arcade and also the Dreamcast version, Rob?
Yes, nice. Both versions.
Nice.
Speaking of the arcade, there are 2 different arcade machines for this. Both had pedals, steering wheel, and gear levers. But one was yellow, had like a little rail kind of used to sit on. While the other was black and had the actual main seat kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Where, you know, remember those arcade games? You could like adjust the seat forward or backward, like it was kind of a gym machine.
Yep.
Yeah, one of those kind of things.
Like Daytona. Yeah, because Daytona had the same cab, didn't they? Yeah.
Yeah, or Lucky and Wild, I think.
Yeah.
No, maybe that was fixed seat, but
yeah,
similar kind of things that was 2-player. Anyway, one of the interesting things about Crazy Taxi is that it was very much going against the grain for Sega at that time. What do I mean by that? I mean, Sega were going through this weird kick in the late 90s where they were doing very, I guess you could call them socially responsible games. So Crazy Taxi came out around the same time as Brave Firefighters and Emergency Call Ambulance.
Okay,
I don't know if you've played either of these
I haven't
games.
Played either of those, you know.
Are you familiar with them at all?
I've heard of them. I know that they are lore, but I've not heard of them. I've heard of them, never played them.
No.
Basically, like, Brave Firefighters is a bit like a light gun game. But you've got like a kind of a fire hose and you have to spray different bits of this building there on fire to put the fire out.
I have heard of it when I was doing, when I was looking back at that SNES game.
It is a little bit like Time Crisis, like similar kind of on-screen mechanism going through like these kind of buildings or whatever, trying to, you know, find stuff. And then Emergency Call Ambulance is interesting because it's kind of the inverse of Crazy Taxi. Like, you basically have to get this sick person from one end of the city to the other, but you can't crash into things, because if you crash into things, they'll die. They will literally die. Like, you have kind of a little screen at the bottom right It's got like their faces going, and there's like kind of the defibrillator machine, like boom.
That sounds awful. No, I don't think I'd want to play that.
No, I saw that on Twitter recently. I think someone posted it. Was it on the PS2 as well, do you think?
Possibly.
These kind of rescued games where you have to...
I don't think I like the sound of that. I think that one's...
But the actual on-screen mechanism, like the actual on-screen gameplay is very similar to Crazy Taxi. Like in the sense where you're basically going through this city. It's a lot more built up, I guess, than one in Crazy Taxi. But you basically have to go past...
Do the cars move out of your way? Or you literally have to drive around them?
You literally have to drive around them. And you can't hit them or anything else. But you also have to go as fast as you can to get these people to the hospital within the time limit.
That sounds like a nightmare for Adrian and his anxiety about that.
Franticness, yeah.
Dude, that sounds awful.
Yeah, like, and, you know, you can't crash into too many things because you lose. Not as bad as a passenger loses, but, you know, you still let the game over.
I'd feel pretty bad if that kept happening.
Weird because, the weird thing about that game is the further on you get, there seems to be, like, some massive crime war or something going on because, like, there are rockets being fired across the screen. It just gets madder and madder, but interesting to kind of think of something like that while at the same time you have Crazy Taxi, which I think we can all agree not the most socially responsible game in the world.
It's not the most socially responsible game in the world. It's not really teaching safe driving, is it?
It promotes craziness to another level, doesn't it?
It does a bit. It does a bit.
Yeah. Anyway, adaptations. Obviously, the big one was...
Dreamcast.
Which obviously, those links to the Naomi system, the version like I am most familiar with because when I was 18 years old, I was working in a Virgin Mega store over winter.
I remember it well, sir. And
they had a Dreamcast in the staff room, and the Dreamcast had Crazy Taxi, which I played every opportunity I could.
They're like, Rob, do you want to come on a team lunch out? And you're like, no, I've just got to drop off some passengers.
I've got my second job to go to, my taxi
I've got my
job.
Second job, yeah, sorry.
This was a shop job, so, like, there wouldn't have been team lunches because that was peak trading hours.
Oh, yeah, God. Would you like a team brunch? No brunch for me, thank you.
Yeah, that was my job. We don't really have to go
into details.
You got
to play Crazy Taxi.
We visited you quite a while. I don't remember you giving me a discount at all, but we did say hello.
I'm not even sure I got a discount. I think you had to work there for a certain amount of time before you got it.
That's why there are no Virgin Megastores anymore.
Yeah.
Well, that and the rampant theft.
Yeah.
I mean, like, part of it was, I know this is a bit of a tangent, but I was on the counter one day, like, I think it must have been just after we opened, and some guy just walked in, grabbed a lot of stuff right near the entrance, and just ran out. It's like, huh.
And no one could be bothered chasing him. They were like, this is too early, man. Let's just let him go.
It's like, what the hell just happened? And also, there are a lot of this is when mobile phones were still relatively early. Mm-hmm. A lot of mobile phones going missing from the stockroom.
It's a 2000, right? So
yeah. I'm not going to name names, but there's one person in particular who was doing it and told me.
They're like, "Oh, Rob, do you want to buy a cell phone?"
I don't want a mobile phone. Don't believe in them. And but like basically some other people tried doing it and they got found out and sacked because the first guy knew where the cameras were looking so he could avoid it.
A bit like Solid Snake because he knew where the cameras were.
Was he hiding under the box as well, you know?
Yeah, he was hiding in a cardboard box. Trying to get all the mobile phones.
Wait, Dylan, do you want to buy a mobile phone? Shh, hide in the box.
Why is there a box talking to me?
Anyway,
tangent over, sorry.
Yes, this came out in the Dreamcast in January 2000. Any differences? But it was a very, like, exact kind of adaptation. Any differences you can think of between this and the arcade you're aware of?
It had more modes, didn't it? I always used to play it on arcade, but I can't remember what the other modes were.
Well, it had mini games and also had a bigger map.
Oh, yeah.
Apparently.
That makes sense.
And do you think it was successful in Dreamcast?
Oh, yeah. Well, I bet it's one of its best sellers. 100%.
Yeah, it's like the go-to thing. If you've got a Dreamcast, you have to have Crazy Taxi.
Was it a launch title? It was early, wasn't it, in the Dreamcast?
It was when did the Dreamcast come out?
Oh, 99?
We need Keith here for that, don't we?
Maybe not quite a launch title.
I don't know if it's a launch title like Soul Calibur was a launch title. I think it might have been just after.
Yeah.
Again, it's a necessity for staple owners. Yeah.
There is apparently some arguments on the internet. Not argument, because I don't think anyone cares that much. But there are different kind of references on the internet saying how successful it was sales-wise. VG Charts puts it number 2.
Wow.
Second best-selling game on the console.
Jeebus.
Number 1 must be...
Soul Calibur?
No. Oh. But basically, Wikipedia puts it at number three. Behind, they both put the same game as number one.
Oh,
Wikipedia puts NFL 2K at second place.
Yeah.
Although that might have been a North American only kind of thing, so I doubt that was too popular in Japan.
You want to tell us what the biggest selling Dreamcast game of all time is?
It's apparently not? Sonic Adventure.
Oh, yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
I think one of those games has aged better than the other two.
Yeah, I think Sonic Adventure has not aged well. I played it the other day, actually. It's not aged well.
Reviews? Do you think it was well reviewed?
What, Crazy Taxi on the Dreamcast? Yeah,
big.
90-something.
Reviews looked to average out about 90%. IGN gave it 96%.
That's
very high, isn't it?
It's very high for a game that's kind of... It's an incredibly fun game. I'd say it's one of the most fun games ever made, but also not the biggest game, I think, or the most variety-filled game.
Yeah.
Anyway, they gave it 96. Games Master gave it 90%.
Yeah.
EGM gave it 91.2%.
Yeah. Very specific. You know, gotta have that
ridiculous rating system.
You gotta have that 0.2%. I don't know. Do they average stuff out over there? Probably.
Wikipedia has a lot of other ones, but no one really cares what stuff you've never heard of.
I do when I talk about my weird
Adrian
games.
Does, and he puts them in his podcast.
Yeah.
That was obviously the biggest console version. But it didn't just come out on the Dreamcast. It just came out on...
You said PS2 earlier.
Yeah, came out on the PS2 in May 2001. So, a bit of a delay at this point, like a year, 4 months
after
Dreamcast.
It's a good version, but it doesn't feel... I know people will tell me I'm wrong and that it's also arcade perfect, but it doesn't... There's something off.
Sega didn't do the port. Do you want to guess which company did
Sega
the port?
Oh, Sega didn't do the port. I did not know that.
Oh.
Who did... Namco?
No. Your favorite company, Dylan.
Oh, Acclaim?
Yes.
Acclaim. Oh, shut up. That's why.
Apparently, and I don't know how reliable this info is, but according to the internet, apparently it outsold the Dreamcast version.
Well, that's understandable because the PS2 greatly outsold the Dreamcast. What have you got the critic scores on it?
It was less well reviewed. Yeah. I think Metascore, the average review score is 80%. But, you know, I don't know if that's really a reflection on the quality of the port as much as the age by this point.
The time, yeah.
I think 2001, things had probably moved on. What, the Grand Theft Auto 3 would have been out?
Yeah, up another level, wasn't it? Yeah.
Which had, obviously, Crazy Taxi elements in it. So.
True.
Yeah. Yeah, maybe that's why. Maybe just they left it too long.
Are you going to talk about a certain Simpsons game as well that's similar or? Because I wonder when that came around.
Oh, yeah.
We will get onto that.
Okay.
But first
of all... road rage.
But, first of all, sequels. Crazy Taxi 2.
Pretty much the same game, isn't it?
Yes, comes out in Dreamcast 2001. It is slightly faster. There are more mini games, and you have the... But there are two other kind of things that are slight differences. I don't know. I'm guessing neither of you are that familiar with Crazy Taxi 2.
I haven't played Crazy Taxi 2, actually.
No, me neither. Just the first one.
The two innovations are you can pick up multiple passengers at a time.
Ooh. Oh, okay. Interesting.
Yeah.
Oh, can you imagine in real life? Sorry, mate. We'll drop you off in a minute. We've got another person coming in.
Yeah, we've got another person coming in,
That'd
mate.
That'd be well
yeah,
annoying.
We've got to ferry them off first to Southampton, and then we'll take you to Edinburgh.
And the other one is... a move called the Crazy Hop.
Is that where the car hops?
Yes, you can hop to the side like to get up to a high level if you're going fast enough, I believe.
What? Huh? Well, like a rabbit hops? Or
more like to the side.
Oh.
Okay.
It's more like a dancey hop, maybe?
I've got Crazy Taxi 2 somewhere. I have to play it now.
Yeah.
Yeah, and obviously, well, I say obviously, it's not really that obvious, but there are also four new drivers. Do you want to guess? You obviously aren't going to guess what their names are, so I'll just tell you.
Blaze.
Yeah.
No, but there is there's one that's not that far off Blaze, not a game.
Blizzard.
Iceman.
Iceman.
Ooh, enough. From Top Gun, maybe.
And Slash.
And Slash?
From what band?
From Guns N' Roses.
Guns N' Roses, yeah.
And there's one called Cinnamon. I guess that was...
From The Chase.
From The
And one called Hot D.
Hot, that's me, isn't it? Hot D?
Hot Dylan.
Adrian, if someone asked you, would you like some Hot D, what would you say?
I would say, no, I'm waiting. No! I'm waiting for Cinnamon to turn up. Buzz
he
off.
He wants a Cinnamon. He wants a Cinnamon. Oh, God.
It's like the Candyman, but the Cinnamon.
Talking about Cinnamon, how great is the Cinnamon cereal? What's it called? Curiously Cinnamon. Or Cinnamon Grahams for our American listeners.
Are you making that up? I've never heard of that.
Yeah. What? I can give you a bowl of that later if you want. Anyway, tangent over.
Yes, tangent over. And then there was another sequel, Crazy Taxi 3 High Roller.
I did not even know that
they
existed.
They had to add High Roller at the end.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's fair to say all of these games are relatively similar. High Roller is, I guess, very based around, like, by this point, minigames are like a big part of it. Stuff like you have to drive through a hurricane with lots of kind of cars flying at you, or you had to kind of pick a lot of people up and take them to, like, big, massive poles sticking out the ground. Yeah. By this point, I think the general feeling was it had got a bit stale.
Right.
Is that a Dreamcast game? I don't suppose it was.
No, I believe it came out on the... let me just check. The PC and the Xbox.
Oh,
that's weird.
Well, this is Microsoft Windows here. Also, there is an arcade release, which I don't think there was for Crazy Taxi 2.
Oh.
I could be wrong.
I think Crazy Taxi 2 might have been console only.
Yeah, Dreamcast only.
Yeah. Yeah. So High Roller, there's tornadoes and stuff.
Yeah. Oh. And, well, I think it's part of the mini games. Crazy Taxi 2 came out on the PSP a few years later as Crazy Taxi Fair Wars.
Fair Wars.
That's we don't like puns, do we?
Fair Wars.
No.
No.
As in F-A-R-E.
F-A-R-E, yeah, no. We got it, yeah.
Yeah. And, Crazy Taxi came out. There are, like, a lot of other later versions. Crazy Taxi Catch a Ride, Crazy Taxi City Rush, but these are mostly kind of mobile games.
Mm. It lends itself Game Boy Advance. To mobile games, because with the auto accelerate on a mobile thing, and you're going around and... I think it works.
I don't know, like, kind of with your thumb and stuff on screen,
It's sort of tarnishing.
All it is, have you tried anything that's racing on a mobile?
No.
All it is that the accelerate is auto, you tilt your phone for the steering mostly, and then you press the screen to brake. That's it. That's all it is. So something like Crazy Taxi would work pretty well, I think.
Maybe.
I might have to go and see if I can download a few.
I just think these mobile games sort of tarnish the image of a legacy a little bit. I don't know.
Yeah, but you've got to keep... I'm getting my old business head on now.
Yeah.
Hey, well, you should have this more than me, you know. Yeah. Cash cow, you milk it. Something like Crazy Taxi, Sega should milk that until it's completely run dry.
Speaking of milking it till it completely runs dry.
They make like a cow version. You have to ride cows around or something.
There was a Crazy Taxi Redemption game.
Taxi Redemption.
Redeemed.
Crazy Taxi Redemption.
Do you know what a redemption game is?
I have no idea what a redemption... Oh, is it something to do with money, isn't it? Money,
yes.
money.
Ooh, like a management sim game, was it?
No.
You have to manage your cabs, maybe.
Like, no, Dylan means money in a far more literal sense.
Yeah, like, what, you win money?
You put coins and you have to roll it from the top to the bottom.
That's it.
Yeah, basically you have to hit certain passengers, which are worth different amounts of points. And you get tickets if you hit certain ones.
And then the tickets you exchange for prizes?
So, like 10,000 tickets for a lollipop, yeah.
So, yes, you basically get 10,000 tickets and then you get a lollipop.
Again, it's tarnishing the image. I'm sorry, Rob. I know what you're saying, Dylan.
Dude, cash cow.
Yeah.
Cash cows, man.
There are, speaking of cash cows, I'm just looking at... I'd never heard of this before, but this is on Wikipedia, so I'm guessing
it's
right.
We love Wikipedia. Thank you, Wikipedia.
Pinch yourself.
They try to make a film version of Crazy Taxi.
Ah.
They sold the rights, and Richard Donner was apparently going to direct the film because he was a big fan of the game. Do you know who Richard Donner is?
Nope, no idea. What has he directed before?
A little film called Lethal Weapon.
Oh, a tiny film called Lethal Weapon.
And also Superman. The first Superman.
Christopher Reeves, yeah.
Reed,
no,
Marlon Brando.
See, I'm just really rubbish with...
Who would be in this crazy taxi film? Do you know?
Well, I don't think they actually got as far as casting it.
Something is telling me Robert Downey Jr. would be awesome as the taxi man.
Who would be Big D? It's got to be Dilsey.
Big D, I'll be in it.
Apparently, it wasn't greenlit because of, quote, an absence of plot elements.
Well, that's the whole game has no plot. The whole game is taxi man tries to make money, not for any kind of purpose, just because to make as much money as he can.
You ever see the film Taxi, either version?
Nope.
Do you know what I even know what I'm
talking
about?
I've seen Taxi Driver.
No, isn't Stallone in one of them? Am I talking rubbish? I might be talking rubbish. You might be thinking I think it's in Driver, else. Isn't he? Yeah, I'll take that back. Oh.
Yeah, Taxi was basically Jean Reno.
Yeah, the French films.
Yeah, no, Luc Besson directed it. I don't know if Jean Reno was in the original. Mm. But basically like a similar kind of thing. You have to kind of get to a certain point at a certain amount of time for some reason. Then I think there is an American remake with Jimmy Fallon and I believe maybe Queen Latifah.
Jimmy Fallon and Queen Latifah.
Let me just...
Pardon me if I don't immediately sign up to watch that.
Let me just look this up, so I... Yeah.
Oh, no, why are you doing that? Yeah, Stallone was in a film called Taxi 3.
Interesting.
Yeah.
That was apparently a sequel to... I'm just on the Wikipedia page now.
Yeah, so I think it's a French film, like I said, but he's in it. Stallone's in it.
He's in it? Was he the star?
No, I think he had like a cameo role, to be fair.
Let's see.
Yeah. So there you go. I wasn't going crazy. So Stallone's on board for Crazy Taxi.
Oh, and we'll I was him on board.
And I wasn't crazy either because Jimmy Fallon and Queen Latifah were in it, as was Giselle, the model who used to date DiCaprio, I think. Giselle Bundchen.
How amazing would Sylvester Stallone be as like the guy who tells you where to go? You know, like the guy who like orchestrates all the taxi, like cab A, you gotta get it. You gotta get it.
Stallone accent. Hey yo, you gotta get it. You gotta get downtown quickly.
What, like where downtown? Where he's just like gotta get to the.
He was in Death Race.
Oh.
Which, you know, where you can hit the pedestrians.
Ooh.
We made the same noise.
What? Like, oh yeah, this film that's 45 years old is really shocking.
Ooh. No, you should get... Oh God, do you guys remember Carmageddon?
Oh, that game was incredible. Yeah, it was quite good actually. But it's shocking, wasn't it?
The whole point was to mow down people.
Have you heard of it, Rob? There's a game called Carmageddon. Literally, you drive a car.
You're just a nutcase driving, mowing people down. Yeah. Aren't you?
I think it uses the Duke 3D engine actually, didn't it?
I think it might do.
Anyway, sorry, Rob. We're
tangent.
Yes. Sorry.
Yeah, because you did mention another game related to Crazy Taxi earlier on. Can you remember what that game was?
Grand Theft Auto?
Simpsons Road Rage.
Oh, yes. Oh yeah. Simpsons. It's all over the front page. You give me road rage.
Yeah, basically, like, you're right. There were similarities. Can you talk about Simpsons Road Rage at all?
Yeah, because I played it like 2 days ago. So, I usually pick Homer because he's like the best character ever made. You just got to take residents of Springfield to certain Springfield landmarks. Like, if Milhouse wants to go to school, you take Milhouse to school. Although he mostly wants to truant and go down the Krusty Burger. So that is essentially it.
Would you say it was similar to Crazy Taxi?
It's like a carbon copy of Crazy Taxi, but with Simpsons characters.
An opinion shared by SEGA themselves.
Did they have something to say about that?
A nice homage to our lovely game. Thank you.
But they don't own the patent on taxi games, do they?
Well, actually, they do own a patent called, and I'm just reading this, 6200138.
Ooh, it's a catchy title.
Indicating a certain game display method, moving direction indicating method, game apparatus, and drive simulating apparatus. Basically, covers the arcade cabinet and the aero navigation system and pedestrian avoidance bits that are in Crazy Taxi.
Oops.
And, yeah, basically...
Dope!
And Road Rage apparently ripped off too many of those things because Sega actually did sue them.
Ouch, who did Road Rage? I don't even know who did Road Rage. I can't remember.
Electronic Arts. The actual developer is Radical Games, but Electronic Arts. Ouch.
Seems mad that you can do that because surely a game is a game. And it's copyright, obviously, but you can't patent bits of a game with the arrow up pointing above the car and that seems mad.
Well, I think it was certain aspects of the collision detection and mechanism and the
that
view.
Seems mad.
Well, did they win the case? You know, Rob.
They didn't officially win, but it was settled out of court. So yes,
they had to settle. Like EA settled. They were that scared about it. That's mad.
I mean, like a very innovative, important patent, really.
You've just blown my mind. I didn't even know that happened. But Road Rage is, it's pretty much, it's like, okay, you see Crazy Taxi and Road Rage.
I think,
if you like Simpsons, get Road Rage.
I reckon they said you can either have $10,000 or an elephant. Do you reckon that was the option? They said.
Well, Road Rage has got like, it's like an original script, isn't it? So they got all the voice actors to voice it and everything. And so it's an original Simpsons product for Crazy Taxi fans. So it's great, actually. It'll cost you about a tenner now.
Yeah.
But it's definitely worth it. Yeah.
So, to close out, this episode, what do you think Crazy Taxi's legacy will be going forward?
Oh my god, so many games have ripped it off since, or borrowed elements of it since. I mentioned Grand Theft Auto. Because the thing about Grand Theft Auto is, it's good following the plots, and they're usually quite engaging, but it's nice to step away from that. And the taxi, it's just ripping off, you know, take this guy from here to here, earn a few more quid to buy yourself more guns. And yeah, it does add that the fact that Crazy Taxi was there meant that Rockstar knew to whack it in. And it does make Grand Theft Auto a better game.
Yeah. I'm a little bit surprised no one made a sort of taxi game before Crazy Taxi. Because it's quite a simple premise, isn't it? Even if it's like a top-down view game, maybe there is one. Maybe I'm talking rubbish, but
well, before that, all that racing games were sprite scaling games that just go forward, isn't it? So,
oh, I suppose
because with something like Crazy Taxi, you've got to have a 3D world, haven't you? You've got to be able to bounce around.
GTA, the first one was top down, maybe. Just saying.
Yeah, yeah, but it's just it is. No, I think I
like Crazy Taxi. Like Rob said, it's just uber fun. No, I didn't. Someone laughs. One person laughs.
I mean, there certainly were kind of top down racing games, especially in the 80s in the arcades.
Yeah, but just had like a pickup person and fling him around element.
I'm trying to think, I like it. Rob, it's a great game. It's a shame it's kind of run out of steam a little bit because at one point it was huge. I remember going to arcades and it was the game to play, wasn't it? It was different. It was different to normal racing games. And that's why I liked it. It stood out from the crowd a bit. Yeah.
Absolutely, yeah. I think like Sega, just the feel of that point, I guess they weren't doing brilliantly in the console department, but man, the arcade games just felt so fresh. That like that same Sega voice that was always in the background of, like, you'd be able to come to the arcades, you'd hear it, all the colors and like the movement. And I think most of all, what I love about Crazy Taxi is it's something you don't really get as much anymore these days, but it's engineered to be fun. There's no thought or story or anything like that or metaphor behind it. It's just pure
games these
fun.
Days are so about plot and this and that. That's why I really like Horizon Chase Turbo, because it's kind of harking back to those old racing games where you can just jump into it. But there's few games being made like that now. But yeah, Crazy Taxi was, you know what you were getting. Just jump in. You don't have to put your foot down. It tells you where the arrow thing tells you where to go after you've picked someone up, and that's it. And you just follow it, and you just have fun. And it is, you know, enjoy the environment. But it's just they don't make games like that anymore.
Yeah,
it was a shame.
But yeah, hopefully they will again soon.
Thanks for listening to today's podcast. We really hope you enjoyed it. If you want to get in touch regarding this.